Hello, how are you? Welcome along to the Taite Music Prize 2015 here from Galatos Live. My name is Vince Wynn.
I'm Esther McIntyre. We're from 95. Proudly presenting this.
Yeah, tonight, 10 with that $10,000 to do what they want with. Last year, we saw Lord walk away with that, but she didn't take the money. She divvied it up between the other nine finalists. So what will happen
this year?
Who knows? Who knows?
Tonight, from Delaney, Davidson, who is one of the finalists. We're also going to have interviews on 95BFM live stream of with the winner of the Taite Music Prize and the winner of the Independent Music New Zealand Classic Record, which this year goes to Herbs.
Yeah, if at any point the feed drops out, we've borrowed a whole bunch of gear from all our friends. So if the feed drops out, maybe Barry's asked for his cord back. Head along to the Twitter website, twitter.com/95bfm.com, and we will provide you with updates from there.
Thanks for joining us tonight. We hope you enjoy it. And we're about to cross pretty soon to the presenter, also known as Lauren Charlotte Wright.
Celebrate and award the 2015 winner of the Taite Music Prize. My name is Charlotte Ryan. It's an absolute pleasure to be back emceeing in Lawrence Arabia.
Vivacious and full character. So we'll see how it goes.
We've got so many exciting things coming up throughout the evening, but to kick things off, Delaney Davidson to perform for us. He's going to play two songs, and then when we come back, we'll continue the show.
Thank you. Hey, thank you, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Delaney. A huge round of applause again. Delaney's actually sticking around Auckland until Saturday. It's International Record Store Day. He'll be performing at Southbound and also releasing a new album that day. The new album is called Diamond Dozen. It's a strange collection of offcuts, apparently. Now, we work in the music industry and we know as performers, sometimes it's rather difficult up here and so we like respect. I sound like a teacher. James, help.
I can't help you with that, Charlotte.
No, you can't. But you know what it's like to be a performer. Is it totally off, you know, distracting when people are talking down the back?
It's enraged me at times, yeah.
Yeah. Right, let's move on. James, you said before that you didn't know why you're here. It's quite obvious to me why you're here. You were the very first winner of the Taite Music Prize back in the day, back in 2009.
Funny that you mention that, Charlotte. Yes, I was the first winner of the Taite Music Prize. And a great honour it is to be invited to come.
Just take it out. You get comfortable.
Because I mean, a lot to you to be received by you here. So thank you. Putting this on for me. No, I actually just wanted to say I was thinking about what I might say about this event because this is a strange thing for me to be doing, emceeing. To be standing anywhere with a microphone and without a guitar is an odd experience. But I was just thinking that it was 5 years ago that my album Chant Darling won this prize, and I was just thinking about how the quality and the breadth and the depth of New Zealand music is, as evidenced by these nominees, is so much greater than it was when Chant Darling won this prize. I'm feeling emotional. But I was just, it really is. It's, I don't know, it, New Zealand music communicates with the world in a way that's so much more nuanced and sophisticated than it did even 5 years ago. And the genres that are on display are all over the place. And I think that if I was to have an album nominated here today, it would be much harder for me to win it, which is bad news. Which is why I accepted the job of co-MC, because I'm hedging my bets. It is a great honour to be invited here to talk to you all. I'm sure it'll be a lovely evening. And thanks for letting me up here, Charlotte, as well. This is your job, Emily. So
I quite like the company. The Taite Music Award is, of course, named after Dylan Taite, an incredible broadcaster. Did you ever meet him, James?
I did once meet Dylan Taite at the Flying Nun 21st, which happened in 2002. And we had a great conversation about Liverpool Football Club. Maybe an hour or so before I passed out in a pool of my own vomit.
Oh.
I was very young and I was very overawed by the whole circumstance. I hope none of you have that misfortune.
Not tonight. Though saying that, tonight couldn't happen without our lovely sponsors. And there's some delicious wine, Jägermeister, beer. Let me run you through the sponsors, in fact. The Taite Music Awards wouldn't be able to happen without IMNZ, Recorded Music New Zealand, New Zealand On Air, the Taite family, thank you, APRA, AM, the New Zealand Music Commission, Native Tongue Music Publishing, NZ Music For You, Pure Capital Thinking, Media Arts Lawyers, Jägermeister, as mentioned, Red Bull Studios Auckland, Moa Beer, Spy Valley Wines, iHeart Radio, Kiwi FM,
RIP,
95BFM, who are streaming this whole event online, Juice TV and McCarthy Design for doing the amazing, heavy Taite Music Award, which you'll see very soon. Right, as well as the Taite Music Award, this evening we also celebrate the Independent Music New Zealand Classic Record. And the Classic Record acknowledges New Zealand's rich history of making fine albums. Shall we invite
Christy Wellen
up to the stage, to talk more about the New Zealand Classic Record.
Thanks. I briefly felt like I'd made a classic New Zealand record, which I certainly haven't done. It's a great privilege for me, as the chairman of IMNZ, to welcome you all to join us here tonight, and it's great to have such a huge turnout. And everyone's quiet at the back, which is great. You've done a great job, Charlotte. And you'll all be happy to know that my speech is going to be a bit briefer because Charlotte's thanked all the sponsors for me. But there are a couple of thank yous I do definitely want to do, and one of those is particularly to Dylan Taite's family and to Jackie. They're huge supporters of this event. And then another Dylan Pellett, who is the Business Development Manager for IMNZ. Give Dylan a little bit of a round of applause. So Dylan is the reason that everything is here tonight, and he's pulled it all together and he's done a great job, so thank you, Dylan. But back to Dylan Taite, and I think he was actually an Everton fan, James, which, I mean, the Liverpool discussion might have gone even worse than it could have done. But he's a local music, he's a journo, he's a legend, and his interviews that remain really are testament to his good taste, his wacky sense of humour, but mostly, which is why IMNZ, we wanted to work with Dylan Taite's legacy, is because his constant desire to uncover, promote, explore, and really just new and exciting music, bring that to the people, no matter what genre or style it might have been. And at IMNZ, we've got a bit less flair than Dylan. Like he was once called Weird by Marilyn Manson. You know, he was a real character. But we try and bring those same principles into what we do. And so at IMNZ, we represent New Zealand record labels. We're a not-for-profit incorporated society, and we represent and advocate for independent New Zealand rights owners. And basically, in the uncertain world that is modern music, and we're all aware of what changes there have been in the last 5 years, we basically try and create connections and open doors and really pave the way for New Zealand music and our music businesses to grow and to reach the world. And I think that in the last couple of years, as James alluded to, that has happened, and we really are leaving our mark on the world scene. And as you can see from the great nominees tonight, there really is some amazing music coming out of here. But without the past, we wouldn't be here now. And all of these albums owe a debt to those that have come before. So it really is a great honour for me to quickly introduce the Independent Music New Zealand Classic Record Award. And I was a bit late coming to this record, but to this day, and for me, I listened to it today at work on Spotify. I felt bad, I probably should have bought it. But it's an album that really captures the imagination, not just through its musicality, but its independent spirit and the sense of community that it just pours out of your speakers. And for me, it's a record that reinforces the notion that music and musicians have a real place and a voice in society when it comes to our national conscience, our culture and our politics. So this year's classic record, and it really is an honour for me to talk about it, is Herb's What's Be Happen. And I think we can all have a huge round of applause for that. And we're gonna watch a short video about it, and then there's gonna be someone much more qualified than me to talk about it. Moana Maniapoto from Moana and the Tribe. Their fifth record was just out recently. She's an amazing performer, an amazing person. She's gonna come and talk about it after this short video. But in the meantime, if you can enjoy the video, and we'll get on with the evening. And thank you for listening and having me. Thank you.
This year, we are proud to acknowledge another recording artist with the award for the Independent Music New Zealand Classic Record. To acknowledge New Zealand's rich history of making timeless albums that continue to inspire us and also define who we are. This year, the award, as determined by the judging panel, goes to Herb's What's Be Happen, which was released on the Ilalakia Mascot Studios founded label Warrior Records in July 1981. With evocative cover art featuring a photograph of police actions to clear Bastion Point in May 1978.
Weird sounding music, it was just kind of backwards music, you know, the beats were different, the whole vibe was very, very different, and yet, you know, it had this capacity to have messages just embedded in it, and so Herb's come along and they just do all of that, and What's Be Happen, I think, is just an absolute landmark in New Zealand music, not just on a musical level, because it was in the vanguard of reggae, but as a political statement.
In his Stranded in Paradise book, author John Dix wrote, What's Be Happen made no impact on the charts on release. Sales were few. Reviews at the time were little more than polite. But it was an auspicious start to Herb's recording career. There wasn't one dud cut on the record. And there was no doubt that Tony Vannotti, who wrote all but two of the tracks, had a strong lyrical touch.
Is very much for most New Zealanders, that we joke about it, but it's true, it's the barbecue music. But reggae, at its inception, particularly in the hands of Bob Marley, who was that huge influence, was a very politicised movement. It was a music that spoke for the underclass, the underdog, the disenfranchised. And into that milieu, here comes the Spandauers, who do exactly that. You know, they address political things in a way that very few New Zealand bands ever have, and they address global issues on Azania. But I always think that one of the interesting tracks on the album is the title track. That's the one where, in fact, they took a bit of a pike at local Pacifica people who were, you know, doing all right here but forgetting about the homelands. So they painted with a very broad brush, but were also quite specific in what they were saying, their targets, in fact.
Lennon, author and musician, said, Herb's recording debut, What's Be Happen, holds up as a vital slice of our cultural history and a landmark for Pacific reggae. Dropping in the dark days of the 1981 Springbok tour, the mini-album showed the band pulling together a strong set of six originals. They knew they were doing something right, when people started asking them about a song off the EP, Dragons and Demons, wanting to know which Bob Marley album it was from. It's still a crucial recording to this day.
You know, one of the things that I always find interesting is that it has been rather disappointing in many ways that reggae, which was a political music, or at least had the capacity to do that in a particular context, that kind of dissipated over a period of time. But in part, that banner was picked up by a new musical movement that came along, which was hip-hop. You know, the first rap single in this country by a Apartheid Posse was A2, a political statement. And so, possibly, we need to remind ourselves that Upper Hutt Posse were actually a reggae band when they started and then rap came along. So possibly the mantle has been picked up in that way. But as, you know, cornerstone statements, I certainly think that What's Be Happened is an astonishing record, not just for its time, but I think it still has resonances today.
Kia ora koutou, ko te mea tuatahi, ka tuaki au I kōnei ki te mihi atu ki a koutou o Ngāti Pātua. Tēnā koutou, e raurangatira mā, tēnā koutou katoa. First, I'd like to acknowledge that we're all standing on Ngāti Pātua land. And I'd also like to acknowledge the Grant Fowl whānau with their special challenges and their fundraiser, which goes on to 11 o'clock tonight. Oh my God, 1981. A little bit hazy. I wasn't into music then. I was a student at Auckland University, and 1981 is a landmark year for anyone who was around. Prior to that, my first concert I hitchhiked up to was at Western Springs, Bob Marley, so I was there. And I was at Hamilton, me and my mate were hitchhiking, and this really dodgy Valiant pulled up with all these guys inside. And it was pouring, and we were looking at dodgy guys, Valiant, pouring, dodgy guys, let's get in the Valiant. Turned out to be Mormon elders, dropped us right to where we went. And Bob Marley, I mean, the gangs were all down the front, but it was one love. It was extraordinary. And it was like, we knew his music, but to see him live gave us permission as Māori and Pacific Island people to feel, you know, that our stories needed to be told. Next major concert I went to was Stevie Wonder, and so it was the crappiest night you'd believe. It was just shite night with, it was pouring, there was mud up to our ankles, and, you know, students, we saved up to go to this concert, all excited, and anyway, when you're not a musician and it's pouring and you're in mud, you have no manners. The support band came out, bugger off, we want to hear Stevie Wonder, go away. Oh, how stink. Anyway, they started playing, and we were like, you know, a bit sour on it. They start playing, and the first song is like, okay, I like this. This is good. And they got going. And then something happened. Like, in our heads, when we closed our eyes, we were somewhere in the Pacific. We were feeling blue skies and sunshine on our faces. And the voices that we heard, they were these strong male harmonies that were new, but they were familiar, like they were the voices I've heard in a million garage parties when all the cousins are singing. And these were men on stage. I mean, they were not a boy band. To me, they were grown-up men when I first saw them. But so they went off the stage, we were like, oh, who's that band, man? Herbs. Oh, that's a funny name, eh? Herbs, oh, okay. And we loved them. And then Stevie Wonder came out and he goes, hi, everybody. And we're like, oh, hey, Stevie. He goes, it's too wet, I'm not going to play it, I want to die. And I remember my huge sense of injustice as he told us to hunt for our tickets because it's going to be postponed. And we scrambled around the mud to find the bloody tickets we dropped. That what was with the bros that came out at the start and in danger of being electrocuted entertained us for quite a while. So I lost a little bit of love for Stevie and gained big love, big time, for Herbs. And I knew when they put out What's Be Happening, they were not wusses, because their cover, as you have seen, was a a strong political statement. And we had come out of the 70s, we had the Māori Land March, we had occupations on Raglan, we had Bob Marley coming, there was lots of stuff going on. It was just, it was a powerful time. And it would get more powerful as the year went on. And some of us would be battened, and some of us here tonight were arrested. And it was a traumatic time. But these guys came out with this music that told us about ourselves. It was a strongly Pacific Island band, but we heard these words, you know, sing that someone's song, Talava! See, we had all the Māori go, sing that song, that Māori song, Kia ora! You know, hello, we never heard this before. And Dragons and Demons and One Brotherhood, great songs, Tony Fornotti, incredible, Phil. And so this band gave us permission, and it didn't just inspire Māori, and that was really important, and Pacific Islanders, because it was a PI band, but it inspired other bands that came. Aotearoa, Ngāhi Wī Apanui, Tommy, it was one of the, that album was one that inspired him. And so that, Aotearoa was a very militant, strong, kaupapa Māori-driven, bilingual band. Staunch as. I was in it for a couple of years, I loved it, and that inspired me. What happened when Herbs was around was a kind of a convergence, and all you musicians will know, you need like an awesome band, you need awesome songwriters, you need a great manager, and they had that in our brother Will Ilolahia, staunch and still managing tonight, and they had the amazing Hugh Lynn, who, you know, if an artist came to town and it wasn't a Hugh Lynn thing, well, you know, why would you bloody buy a ticket? He had it totally covered. And so he had the events sorted, but he also had Mascot Studios, and where Dalvanius would later record his album, and he had Warrior Records. So they had all these things going on. So tonight is about acknowledging whakapapa, and I just did a mentoring workshop in the last 3 days for Ngāti Whātua, and telling kids, you know, you go and you listen to this album, you go and you listen to Air 2. There are only so many landmarks in New Zealand music history. And these are important ones. They're stories about ourselves. So acknowledging whakapapa tonight, and very proud and very honoured to give to introduce to you, and I've got to get the terminology right, representatives of Herbs, and that includes Mr. Will Ilolahia and Hugh Lynn. Please put your hands together for this year's official inductees into the Independent Music New Zealand Classic Record category for a landmark album that continues to inspire us. Thank you. Say anything at this time.
Okay. Kia ora, tātou. 34 years ago, I'm getting feedback, 34 years ago, it seems like a long time, but it was exciting. There was, we were doing a lot of work with Australians, and Australians were sort of a bit more ahead of us, really. The industry itself was more confident about the artists. But I always believed that New Zealanders had this bubbling creativity, which is being shown. And if you take that time in 1981 and look at us now, we're kicking ass out there in the music field. I mean, with the very beginning of it, that's probably an exaggeration, but we're starting to penetrate internationally. And I think that we've got something really special because we're a long way away from the influence of Europe and America, and our view of the world is different. Anyway, this award, which I'm accepting, we've got one award, it's metal. I don't know how we're going to spread it around everybody. What I want to introduce you to Will Iolahia, because when this award came up, we started to think about the number of people that are involved. You see the artist on stage, of course, but behind the artist, there are the machines, and in this case, the people that were doing the recording. So I'm going to introduce you to Will at the time, who was a major player, and he introduced me to a whole series of things, like the concept of a social profit as against a money profit. And we've had a relationship for all that length of time. But anyway, there's Will. Where is he?
Yeah.
Oh, there he is.
Katangi te titi. Katangi te kaka. Katangi te kohiki ahau. Tihei Māori ora. Te uhuwhanga whakatapu ko sa whaki. Te whakamalo atke. Ka Moana, ka you, Phil Toms, Ross France, Phil Yule, and Spencer Fusimaloi. Apologies from Tony Fonoti. He's become an Australian, stuck in Queensland, and we remember the late Fred Fariato. Not many people realise that Herbs actually was a multicultural band. You see the, and I think my brother Dilworth Karaka is being typical Māori, excuse sister, probably Māori time, you'll probably arrive here a bit later, I think. But yeah, but thank you, Hugh, for asking me to speak on our behalf. We actually, as you heard, it was a really hard time. But I would like you to know that Herbs was a multicultural band. Phil was our first bassist on the album. The song Azania about South Africa was written by our lawyer and also a musician for Diatribe, Ross France. And the person that was behind the mixing desk and all that, the producer, is Phil Yule. My cousin, Spence Fusimalohi, one day came to me and said, can you come and manage this band? And if you remember the Blues Brothers movie where you had a band in the corner with bottles flying and all this, this is what he introduced me to, a band called Herbs at the Trident Hotel. With Hugh, we were able to make an impact. And this album, we really thank the organisers for acknowledging this album because and acknowledging Dilworth's comment that this is the best album that Herbs has done. Herbs represents Aotearoa. And you can see it tonight. Leve leve malanka tawatu.
Hi, I'm Phil Toms. Yeah, it was an amazing time, 1981, Springbok tour, and, what was it, the Dawn Raids, and there was a big Maori land movement. Herbs managed to put the Maori land movement and the Springbok tour together and say, what's be happened? And that's what we did, and it was the most political album ever in New Zealand yet, so far, I think. First, I'd like to acknowledge Hugh, who without whom none of this would be possible, because he owned Mascot Studios and he gave us 5 weeks in there, which is really amazing. Not only that, he brought out Black Slate, who were a reggae band at the time, and we were support for Black Slate, and he brought out UB40, and we were the support act for UB40. So Hugh was amazing, and Will Olalah here too, who doesn't get much recognition considering the mammoth effort he put in, and his great skill as a promoter and as an organiser, as a manager. And I'd just like to say that it's a little strange to be awarded for this album 34 years later, despite it not being allowed to go to CD. It still gets an award and nobody's even heard it. So I'm hoping that we will be allowed to print it to CD. Thank you very much.
I'm Phil Yule, the little guy who they were probably worried about, how do you make them sound big? And I just worked out, you turn the bass and the kick drum up really loud and it works. Thank you very much, Hugh, for giving me the job at Mascot years ago. It was just the right place, right time, and these guys who are sort of twice my height and size came into the room and I was like, oh, and they look a bit street, I'm not quite on the street. But I learned how to be on the street, and it was just a joy and a privilege to have recorded it. You don't know you're making a classic album at the time. You're just doing the best job you can and recording these guys. And as you saw on the video, I mean, I was impressed. Don't know who did that, but it was really good. The sound, I mean. You just record them as they were, and that's how they were. It was just laid down in the studio. And it's just fantastic to have revisit this 30-odd years later. Thank you very much.
We actually forgot to mention it, but Herbs, as well as that beautiful award designed by Stephen McCarthy, you also get these, two of these to share amongst... Okay, yeah. Pass them over. Anyway. Shall I? Oh, that check. That will come later. Yeah.
That was. I had a chill during that little waiata. It was very beautiful. Last year's winner of this award, of the Taite Music Prize, was in the rare position of not particularly needing the prize money, despite hailing from one of Auckland's roughest postcodes. And Dylan Pellet canvassed some of the last year's losers.
James.
For what they did with the money that was so generously donated by the winner of last year's award. And so... Jonathan Bree apparently went into day-to-day stuff. The Phoenix Foundation used it to record the Tom's Lunch EP, and they gifted the Red Bull studio recording time to At Peace. Daniel McBride of Sheepdog and Wolf brought some new Yamaha NS10 studio monitors to record and mix the new album. Unknown Mortal Orchestra said it probably went on my kids' school fees. And Beast Wars bought a 1970s double neck SG to rock the fuck out. David Dallas and At Peace did not respond to the question.
Drugs, maybe.
But anyway, to she doesn't have to address that, but I'd like to introduce Ella Yelich O'Connor to the stage to give her last year's winner speech or something.
For having me. This is amazing. I feel like those were such beautiful speeches and I'm probably not qualified enough to be speaking. That's okay. Thanks so much to IMNZ and Red Bull and all those other sponsors that you mentioned and Galatos for putting on this event. This venue is so great. I love it so much. Played my first ever show here. I was probably really crap. I can't remember. Okay. I'll tell you the truth. I am a little bit nervous about speaking tonight. I speak publicly a lot at award shows and other events with varying degrees of preparation, but more often than not, I am the underdog. I'm from that country Americans definitely can't place on a map. I'm young and comparatively scruffy looking, and there's nothing really wrong with my face, but I do some things with it that make you feel uncomfortable. Here, though, I'm about as far from an underdog as you can get. Sitting in my pop castle in Morningside, churning out hits, drinking the blood of 660 for strength. And especially in this room, surrounded by some of the most technically talented, painfully underheard musicians New Zealand has to offer, it's fair to say I'm the odd one out. So you can understand my apprehension at giving this speech. I emailed the Taite Prize people for a little help. They emailed back, acknowledge the award and your achievements this year. I checked to see if there was more. Maybe the email had been formatted incorrectly, but that was it. Thank you. So, the award. The award is awesome. It's really heavy. I probably spend more time oiling it than SJD spends oiling his six-pack. The award is special. It's special to me because it showed me that the stories I had written with Joel Little meant something to people who actually really care about music, and that is a really cool thing. It's special to me because I make almost stupid music, simple music, pop music, the kind of music this room is generally a safe haven from, and I understand how difficult it must have been to award it here. I couldn't hear if that said crap or great. I'm just gonna roll with it. It humbled me and made me happy to know that simple music can move hardened musos like it moves me. The award is weighty in more ways than one. It represents memories of being a young person in New Zealand, discovering music not all of my friends liked, going on Bandcamp, going to shows, I'm sure many of you did and still do. My life and musical memories are inextricably linked with the musicians that surround this award this year and in the years past. I went to see Electric Wire Hustle, where they played a free concert during the Rugby World Cup. What was that, 2011? Front row on that barrier would not give up my spot for the life of it. I don't think it was like, I probably wouldn't have had too hard a time hanging on to that barrier. Anyway, it was probably about 7 p.m. as well, I remember, but it felt late and it blew my mind. I sat with Holly of Tiny Ruins at Conch last year. We had dinner with a mutual friend and I remember thinking she was the smartest girl I'd ever met. And I love her record so much. I can see it, so that's awesome. My friend put Grayson Gilmour on a mix CD. We had a thing we would trade mix CDs complete with handmade cover art. I remember listening to Humble Punk Rock at the bus stop. I saw Tom Scott not too far down the road at a Farside concert at the studio back in August 2012. I Googled that date. And I said hi very nervously, and he went like this. Which I thought was very kind of Pharrell of him. By the way, at the time, it was the cool thing to say you had shouted Tom Scott a sesh. If I had a dollar every time I'd heard that story, I'd have enough to shout Tom Scott a sesh. These are real stories, real people, looked up to by thousands, including me. These musicians... Taxi? Whoa. These musicians and dozens more recognized by this award make up who I am. They're the fabric of all of us, I guess, and that is the weightiest thing I'm ever going to have on my mantelpiece. The second half of the speech is supposed to be about my achievements since winning this award, but I know that no one cares about those, so here are some more personal triumphs of the last year. I've learned how to play a show. That doesn't sound like a particularly big thing, but I went from not being the kind of person that would know how to entertain a room full of people to just being so happy and so comfortable on stage and having such a good time every night and going to play these crazy festivals in Atlanta or in Portugal or California or wherever, and it being such a cool thing for me. Whether I'm... thank you. And I'm sure you guys know what it's like, whether you're sick, as I'm sure many people are on the road, or really mad about something, or just feeling shitty. You know, that has been learned. Last year, I was able to go on stage in Las Vegas, playing on the roof, really weird hotel in Vegas, very weird in general. It's like for me, because I'm obviously not old enough to go out and like rave in Vegas, you know, I'm just like in my hotel room. But everything is like, all the food is really weird, I don't know, very loud, very bright. And so it kind of just like fucks with your head a little bit. Me and my sister were there, my older sister, and we were just like really tired and really sick. And we had a fight, and she actually scratched a bit out of my arm, which I still have the scar from. So, you know, now I can go on stage following stuff like that, so it's cool. I've gotten really good at hand washing my undies in hotel bathrooms. I can do just about anything on 4 hours sleep and an energy drink. I wasn't gonna say Red Bull because this is like, I don't know, that's a Red Bull thing. But, okay, Red Bull. I managed to only make half a fool of myself in one time. It's like amazing effect on people. And he walked past me and I'd done the street. It feels like a stumble forward. It feels like reaching out. And that, I guess, is the main thing. That we all make this stuff and feel this way, like something is in its right place, like we're whispering or shouting a truth. In some ways, that feeling of a chorus jangling around in your head or of listening through to the final master of something new, that's the prize-winning part. And all of you deserve it, both the actual, shiny, heavy prize and the feeling. Well, each of you have a fantastic night. You're going to smash it.
Proud of you. You're always so eloquent. You're so good. Now, it was mentioned before, but Grant Fell, who is a huge part of the New Zealand music community, he played in Children's Hour and also Headless Chickens. He's very ill at the moment. There is a celebration happening at Golden Dawn. Post Don McGlashan's performance, if you feel like going down, I think they'll be there till about 11 p.m. But is there a weird sound? Anyway, sorry.
It's just people having a good time, I think.
Oh, right. Good, good, good. That's what it's all about. But most importantly, it's about the 2015 Taite Music Prize. Without further ado, the nominees are...
All members of Independent Music New Zealand. They now have released albums during 2014. Send me a vision. Electric Wire Hustle. My favorite band. Peace. At Peace and the Plutonian Noise Symphony. Aldous. Delaney Davidson, Slow Down Love. Thank you. The Taite Music Prize 2015, presented by Independent Music Museum. Thanks to all our sponsors.
I'd like to invite to the stage to present this year's Taite Music Prize, Damien Vaughan from Recorded Music NZ.
Thanks very much. Recorded Music is incredibly honoured to have been there from the beginning with the Taite Music Prize. This is the sixth year we're presenting it, and it's an absolute honour to present the prize itself, but also the $10,000. Well done to IMNZ. I just want to thank IMNZ. Can we have a round of applause for them? Put it Jakob for Signs.
Shock. This is my worst nightmare, by the way. There's a reason why we're an instrumental band. Good. That's pretty heavy, dude. Do some damage.
This is great.
I think there were times when we were recording this where it didn't seem like it was going to come together. It was a really hard album to make. We had some trials and tribulations, like there was no tomorrow. But we sort of stuck to it, and we had lots of help with some friends. Paul McClaney really helped me out a long time ago, and kept helping me out through this time. Musically, and you know, as a friend, Chris Chetland came through at the end when it was all sort of seeming a little bit too hard. He sort of really helped at that time. Dave Home, Nick Blow, time with the mix, and our families for not seeing us very much throughout the whole process. They put up with heaps. And so big thanks to them for hanging in there with us. And we're really honoured to win this. I'm still in shock, and I don't even know what I'm saying right now. So thank you very much. I'm honoured.
We are off to Europe next week, so it's probably going to...
Yeah.
Thank you all
very much.
Congratulations, Jakob. So, so good.
Performance.
That didn't sound teacherish at all. That's good. Yeah. Media Arts Lawyers, New Zealand Music for You, Pure Capital Thinking, Jägermeister, Red Bull Studios, Moa Beer, Spy Valley Wines, iHeartRadio, Kiwi FM, Juice TV, McCarthy Design, and to you for all coming along. It's been a fantastic night. Don McGlashan has a brand new album coming out very, very soon called Lucky Stars. His new single, so called Stars, the Spy Valley Wines and Moa Beer.
And after Don's finished, as Charlotte mentioned, feel free to head down to the Golden Dawn to support the Grant for Grant.
Mr. Don McGlashan.
All right, we're going to play now. Hi, everybody. We've got sort of 2.5 quietish ones, and then there's the rest of them. There's like 3.5 quiet. Could talk if you really have to, but. This is one of the quiet ones. Sanctuary, but they locked the door. I looked for forgiveness on the stony shore. Tried to pay the bold man to get me across. Said your money's no good, son.
Yeah.
is full of whisper, and I'm waiting by the door, and I've thrown down my weapons anymore. So hollow. I can feel a storm coming, and I hope I can stand my ground when the trumpets sound. When the trumpets sound, I will pray. I will pray. Hold on to your loneliness. Hold on. If you feel fly through the streets, and there's so much beauty, and there's so much strength, you have to look away. Look away, look away, and the pain has gone, and the ice can melt. You've got so much love, stand up for yourself. Hold on to your loneliness, it'll make you strong. It'll help you find your way home. Hold on to your loneliness. Hold on. Thank you. This is one called On My Way to You. Okay, here we go. Speedo blurs and the white lines roll through the clouds and the telegraph poles. Little farmhouses up in the hills, dairy factories and timber mills, and every valley shall be lifted high, and every mountain will fall. Cause I'm on my way to you. I'm on my way to you. I woke up this morning expecting rain, kept my foot down and it never came. Petrol and road dust on my tongue. Every step that I if I was gone, the waves would roll on, the waves would roll on, roll on as deep as deep. See nothing to guide me, no star in the sky, no seabirds behind to wheel and to cry. If I should vanish, if my story was done, the waves would roll on, 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 the waves would
oh.
feel like I can't hear a goddamn word I'm saying. We just had a performance.
To be honest, we're right by the speaker. I can't hear what you're saying at all, but we are joined by the lovely lads from Jakob taking out the prize tonight. Jason, if I can throw to you quickly, what are we talking about here? We're talking about 8 years on a bit of a hiatus, and you've come back and you've taken out the big award tonight.
Yeah, 8 years, it's blown me away. It's crazy. I'm still in a bit of a... Still in a bit of shock, actually.
Because over what was holding you up those 8 years?
It's a whole string line of injuries, family commitments, work commitments.
Injuries that we can attribute to a bit of time off. I mean, does it feel quite surreal being here 8 years after you know, had that break and to win this award with the returning album?
I still can't believe it. Like, it's been a long, long, long hard road to get to this, to the finish this album, and to even get nominated for this is phenomenal. But, you know, to win it is mind-blowing, yeah.
It's quite a special thing, I feel.
Unreal, yeah. Totally unreal.
That's awesome. So three hand injuries down. Have you guys learned anything about your anatomy during this process?
I think, A, stay away from sharp knives and pumpkins.
Yeah, use a meat cleaver or a tomahawk or drop it on the ground, cut it in half with pumpkins. Don't do the stabbing motion with pumpkins.
Not a good idea, man. Not a good idea.
But some things we cannot control, so good effort. What else do we need to mention? I was just saying off camera that all of the albums tonight have very small print, and I think Jakob gets the prize for that, although At Peace has no print on their album cover. You know, it's a humble return to fame, and I think it's a really beautiful image, and I love that tiny little, you know, this is who we are, don't forget. But tell us about...
Actually, we were talking before, we should have had faces on our album because...
Everyone else does.
Because everyone else has their face. Yeah. Look at the boys. Look at the boys. Look at the girls.
Apart from At Peace.
Yeah.
Tiny Ruins, still a depiction of a lady.
Our artwork is from Mike Hawksworth.
Egocentric,
so
but not
to him.
Too egocentric.
And so what inspired the art? Did you just go to him with some sort of brief, hey, we've got these kind of songs, or did he come up with it knowing you guys personally?
No, the artist, we went into his room about using on the wall.
Out to ISIS, is that, I see there next to Tool, there seems to be some sort of thank you to ISIS.
We were a bit worried, to be honest.
ISIS the
band. We'd like an explanation.
ISIS the band, not the others.
Not the terrorist group. There we go. Just confirmation.
We should have done our research.
Apologies,
Jakob, Mr. Jakob.
Hey, so congratulations, guys. Thoroughly enjoyed it. In terms of where you go to from here, what do you
go? Europe and spend on the tickets to get there, right?
Yeah, Wednesday. We leave on. Next Wednesday.
How long are you going to be?
3 weeks. 3 weeks. It's 15 shows across different countries. So, yeah, it should be cool.
So exciting. For a band with no words, you have said a lot with this album.
Nice.
And you deserve all of the glory that comes with this really special award. Thank you guys so much.
And I'm just glad that you haven't had any involvement with ISIS, to be honest. You know, we're a bit confused there. Ooh. Behind the scenes, but we're glad to find out
Prince
it's ISIS the band.
Prince was getting in a bit of a state. Look, they're supporters of ISIS.
Hey, and thank you very much, guys, and enjoy the night. And that is it on the BFM Live. Thank you tonight. If it's their equipment, we want to say it's involved to Augusto, College Hill Media, and